of the work of Tony Fretton Architects the week before last, and there were already so many people here in the lecture hall and the band playing. I didn't get to do an introduction for the exhibition then, but I do want to really take this opportunity to thank the people from Tony's office, Tony himself, and Jim McKinney and others who worked on putting the exhibition together, as well as Andrew McKenzie from the AA and his crew, and Kate Jones and others for putting together a really wonderful exhibition, which I'm sure all of you have enjoyed and will still go on enjoying for a while. I think some of you might probably be familiar with a conference that we had here on an exhibition last year called Beyond the Minimal, which documented the work of four Austrian practices. And one of the things that we've tried to do in the school over the last few years is really to look at practices who have continued, obviously, some of the key aspects of the project of modernism, but in a rather critical fashion, and have made a contribution to this project, so to speak. And at that conference, we tried to also think about people who had really were part of this group of people who really had thought in very important ways, had made important contributions to contemporary architecture, and we invited Tony to participate in this conference. And I think there's obviously a lot that is always said about the question of minimalism and so on, and I think this has already been rehearsed many times, that especially in the UK, this has really become very much part of a stylistic operation. And what I think is very critical about the work of Tony is that it really works in rather unsettling ways. It doesn't really follow this approach that seems to be so prevalent in the work. I think all of us are very much familiar with his Listen Gallery project, and of course that's the most well known of all the projects to date. And if anyone asks people in London to really mention a key project of the last 10 years, I think that project has to be mentioned as one of the important projects that have happened in London, because it works in ways where it both fits into the existing fabric as a kind of project of anonymity and at the same time a kind of project of uniqueness. And in many instances, when modern architects build new buildings, it always becomes a kind of project of uniqueness as a sort of special case thing. But to actually construct a modern project, to construct a new project that both works in this idea of a kind of older tradition of architecture, a kind of architecture of anonymity, and at the same time has very special qualities, very unique qualities about it, this is a very rare kind of situation to really find architects who can develop their work in this way. And I would like you to join me in welcoming Tony Fretton, who's obviously going to delight us with other projects. Thank you.
Thank you, Gerald. Am I working? Good. Well, two things to start. One is to address why the exhibition is called Architecture, Experience, and Thought. And I think this flies in the face of a lot of the way that architecture has been proposing itself for some time, which seems to entail a belief that there's a rhetorical or a theoretical position which precedes making architecture. And then the work comes from that. But actually my experience, and I think the experience of most other architects, is utterly different. The architecture is what you do. It's the craft of what you do. And in the way that people who write would find that word unexceptional, I believe it's a word you can apply to architecture, because it's the internalization of all of those things which surround you as an architect, and I would say also the ability to refract the things that please you outside architecture all of those things that you read, all of those things you see, whether they be finely wrought or simply pleasurable, comes through the architecture that you make. And I think it's best explained, this aspect of it is best explained by showing you the work. But the second part of the title, experience, is... this is driving me mad, sorry. the experience aspect is that in my mind, as I design the piece of building, I experience it, I see it, I imagine it. It's real to me. And then again, when it's built, we experience it again. We experience it in a different way. And often at that stage, there are aspects of it which we didn't consciously put into that scheme. And there's a point here, that creative activity is of a special kind. It's very different from, let's say, what I imagine it's like in the practices which go for or seek precision, let's say law or some aspects of science. Creative activity produces objects which then provoke people or stimulate people to have ideas, impressions, to have thought, and it gives that thought in a very peculiar way, as often as enjoyment or being intriguing. But I believe that the thought that ensues when you experience a piece of work or an object or a piece of music that comes from creative practice produces genuine knowledge, but knowledge of a type which is reinterpretable. That's the key difference for me. It's imprecise. It doesn't want to be more precise. So the experience of it is a fundamental component of what we understand architecture to be in the office. And thought comes very, very late. I mean, of course, you think as you make the building, as you make the propositions for the building, and you reflect on all of the other buildings that you've made, you reflect on your experience. But afterwards, this experience that I described eventually gives you a series of, let's say, conclusions or deductions from what you've done. So that is to explain the title, and I think going on from that, the title of this lecture, which is Poetry Makes Nothing Happen, it's a line from a poem that I like very much, written by W.H. Auden, which I'm sure I'm misusing, but poetry, I mean, clearly, poetry and architecture and literature do make things happen, but in a very particular way. They're not instrumental. And you see, one of the curses of architecture is that it somehow places itself or believes itself to be in the world of practicalities. It isn't. The world of practicalities is actually a world of agreements and fictions, very necessary ones, but they're not, you know, they're not as empowering or propelling as we think. The capacity of objects which are thoughtful, which evince that kind of experience that I just described, is to act, I believe, in culture as a whole. It's a tiny, if it's working, it provides tiny components which, together with other tiny components from other fields, whether it be politics or fine art, give us the things by which we think, give us the ideas by which we think, and especially in architecture's case, gives us the means to see a city. It makes sense of the present, whether you like it or not. Even if you design badly, you make the visual culture within which people see the city, and from which they can only escape by their imaginations. Mercifully, you're defeated from being totally oppressive by the imaginations of people. So, in the work that we do, we're very conscious of how there's a particular role that I see that one would adopt, which is to consciously make objects which are highly created, very open to interpretation, and to which people can attach their imaginative self and their fantasies and live out their lives. It seems to me that there's a necessity to provide structure, but do you have to do it in a way which is truly libertarian? So I'll now talk about a project that we did. I'll start with a project that we did in Swain, Hampshire. Okay. And some of these issues will become clear, I hope. Sway is it's 7 kilometres or so from the south coast of England, and it's a suburb of Southampton, or it's close to Southampton. And I guess was a rural town until the Victorians brought the railway, which runs through here. And it gradually has become a commuter town. And this is a funny and simplified drawing of the high street. That's the railway, as I say. This is the main street. It really is like this. That building there is that one there. And my client on this project, a really lovely woman called Linda Fredericks, who was the director of the gallery, which I should tell you is situated here in this drawing, was in the middle of it all, went to Los Angeles for a holiday. And I did this drawing, which showed her town as like LA. So I mean, it's a bit of a joke, because actually, it's a joke. and she liked Frank Gehry very much. I gave her one of my books on Frank Gehry, which I'm not sure I ever got back, but that's probably the price you pay. And in a funny kind of way, the building that I'll show you has a slight love of Gehry. It was rural, and it then had a spate of buildings, which I don't have illustrations of, which were built, I suppose, in late Victorian times. They were rather gross neo-vernacular buildings of a type which, if you're British and you've travelled in this part of the country, you would recognise. And then a spate in the 30s of this kind of building. But also, very interestingly, there's some very eccentric and bizarre building in this area. For instance, there's a concrete tower and a concrete house, the owner of which I just met, very charming doctor called George Lewis, who lives in this house, which was built by, a judge who came back from India, impelled with the desire to build in concrete. I mean, God knows why. And he did, and he built a concrete tower. So there's, within this rather quiet building, quiet area, there is this high degree of fantasy. And even in buildings like this, which would have been built by a speculator, there is this strange and rather repressive element of fantasy. And in the 60s, another kind of fantasy, or rather, let's say, alpine fantasy. This house on my drawing is here. So you see, all of this, which is highly fantastic, is become ubiquitous. Somehow it's become absorbed and controls, as I just said, it controls the way that we see the world. But it controls the world for these people in a different way. It's become conventional. And it's that aspect which I think I was trying to touch on as I made... This is going to turn into a nightmare. Right. Excuse me. As I made a building which attached to this building. This was original, which is depicted. Hang on. Joel, I've touched everything in the wrong place. I don't always do that. Sometimes I touch things in the right place. Anyway, this, I hope. This building was original, and it's one of those buildings that I described. It's a highly concocted style, rather badly concocted, and very derivative of, let's say, people like Norman Shaw or the arts and crafts movement. And on the back of it, we built this. So, let me see. What we built in the back, from the back, looks like this. And this is an art center. I'll show the first two buildings I'll show will be art centers, the second two will be residential, and the third one will be a dance school. And this is an arts center which we built with lottery money, one of the first lottery projects, in the moment when lottery funding was producing work with really good heart, which I regret to say isn't the case now. And one thing to say is that when I approached this building, when I first came to this building, this car park, as it went round the back of the building, kept rising and was a field, and you could touch the roof of that building from behind. It was incredibly charming. That space behind the building had a character which I remember from living in suburbs when I was a child, which was a very unclaimed space, a place within which people, in a very unconfined and unstructured way, would have their fantastic moments as children, and it was something that we wanted to respond to. So for that reason and other reasons, we built behind this building and buried this building in the ground. Now, this building's ceiling heights were very low, and the demands of an art gallery in these spaces, which are the art spaces, where the ceiling should be very high. So in concealing it in the ground, and perhaps you can't appreciate it, but the ground level of this new building is on the line that I'm drawing with this pen here. What we were able to achieve, which I'll illustrate with this slide and the next slide, is that from every angle, this building, which has rather tall spaces in it, actually seems to be about the same size as that. So it's an illusion. Let me see. Good. These slides show something of what we were trying to do here. We were trying to work with, how can I put it? When we work on projects, we make a number of decisions. And those decisions have a pragmatic basis, but also they have an expressive basis. And in this project, we wanted and had wanted for a long time to build in wood, to build in wooden frame structures. And the reasoning for that, in a mild way, is that it has an ecological advantage. The construction or the fabrication energy used in fabrication of timber buildings is significantly less great than in timber. Timber has a greater thermal capacity. It also has an expressive capacity. So we built this new building entirely in a timber frame. And we were very interested in this roof because we were also working on another project, which I'll show later, which had an enormously distorted roof for very, very pragmatic reasons. And I became entranced by this. I also, as I said earlier, was very engaged with the work, had been for a long time, very engaged with the work of Frank Gehry. And it mystifies me. I mean, I don't have that imagination to make this degree of expression in forms that he does. And I admire his work very greatly. For me, he's a late 20th century master. But so in a strange way, there's an expressionistic building in here wanting to get out, but it's only able to express itself through a fairly rule-driven approach. And what we did here is we made this roof, which was a pyramidal roof, four-sided pyramid, cut the top off for a roof light, and then to keep the roof light square, as you'd appreciate, if you cut the top off of a pyramid, the shape of the roof light would be this. So to make it square, we suppressed the backside edge of the, or pushed the back edge of the roof in. We got this tremendous twist in tiles, which you can do with slates and tiles, you can do anything with slates and tiles. So we got this rather strange form in the roof, which looks at the other forms around it, sits within it in a provocative way, I feel. Sorry, one thing I'd meant to say prior was this, that it won't go on like this, I promise you. I'll get the hang of it in about 25 years' time. This space here, one thing that happens quite a lot in the work is that in the construction, in the decisions that we have to make, for instance, in this area, which is a visiting artist studio, we had to set that studio back because there was a tree next to it. And that created a particular kind of space between the window and the outside space, which has a degree of privacy which I value very much, and that appears in other projects which I'll show. This slight articulation of events in the building as they touch the outside, as they connect with the outside, so that trees in the distance, slight amounts of enclosure in adjoining buildings and the building itself, create a space, or volume in fact, outside the window, which has an ambiguity. It's deeply private and intimate. Hold on. So these are two photographs of the two buildings together. I mean, evidently this is at night and this is in the day. And it shows this relationship of massing. This tree also, as we designed, this tree was part of the ensemble of things which was in the visual imagination as we designed it. So there was a series of decisions to make different types of gallery spaces. This one, which I'll illustrate inside, which has a conical roof. This has a roof like a Boy Scout's hut. and there's another gallery within the existing building. So I'm going to use this photograph to illustrate the plans, and the plans are oriented in the same sense as the photograph. So this point here is this elevation here, and this is a room which is the office. This is the first floor plan and the roof plan. That office is in that space there, and it has enormous charm. Its location up there has a certain kind of significance. You can't see up into it, it doesn't announce itself, and yet you can hear people in it, so it has a very particular quality. It's both related to the totality of spaces, and yet it has the right degree of privacy that you need to for the director to be out of the action. And this is the ground floor plan. Again, that point there is the entrance here. So, in planning and massing, as you make a plan, you think of many things. Whenever we're making decisions, we're always thinking about four or five different implications. For example, here, this is a store. These are the WCs, that's the entrance. That means that these spaces, which can be quite low, can make this part of the building produce an eaves height which is the same as the existing building. So as you walk around here, this looks the same height as that. And then, as I said earlier, these spaces are taller, and they mass up behind this, so the effect is lost. So the initial impression, or the impression from all sides, in fact, is that the building's very, very small. And in cutting the ground away, perhaps you can just see here, there's just a little bit of a wall there. We made a flat courtyard, so the ground here is higher than that. That's a seat. And this along here, this wall angles. And we cast the top of the retaining wall with a sharp edge so that the grass comes over it. So it looks like the grass has been cut. And one thing that we wanted to do was to make this building be both present, evident, and solid, and yet a sort of abstract version of itself. And if we're talking about the listening gallery, one thing that I think it's true to say about that building is that there's a huge lesson from artists such as Carl-André or Lewitt, which is that if you want to make an object which seems to dwell in the well-known, to dwell in the mundane, to be very, very similar to very averaged-out objects, or in this case, objects which are very similar to it, and yet you want it to maintain its presence and not be absorbed in the surroundings in the way that those houses I showed earlier are, you have to make a conscious effort to maintain a tension between that absorption and what you do. I can't express it more clearly than that, but it's a matter of being fine and sharp about what you do in relation to, well, in the appearance of what you do. So, to continue with this plan, you walk in here, and then there's a very large gallery there, this gallery here, and then an artist studio at the back, and another gallery within the existing building, and then this is a workshop and a reception area. And I'm going to take you through, some of this lecture is going to be very direct. I'm attempting something here, which is to be almost, well, pedestrian, I would say, in the true sense that we're going to walk through the building. So if you walk inside there and look, you see the beginnings of this gallery. And in these gallery spaces, the attempt was made to make them appear both recognizable by artists as art space which they valued. Let's put it this way, that they would want to exhibit in those spaces because they would have a higher degree of legitimacy in relation to other art spaces they may see, while at the same time these spaces would have an uncanny resemblance to the scout hut you grew up in, to other buildings, or even invented rather neo-vernacular buildings. So there's a play here between spaces which artists would want and spaces which people would feel very much at ease in. And I'd like to dwell at this point on how you go in. This window here is here. So somebody walking into the building passes that window, and it means somebody from the reception can see them coming in. But it also means that the building, the original building, of which this is a part, looks back on the new building. And that's something that we tend to do in the work. We make elements that we make the building look back on itself so that it's a process of rediscovery as you walk through it. And from inside this gallery looking back, that's what you see with this long roof light. Each of these spaces has a different type of light. This one is rather luminous, and the and this gallery, which is to the side of it, would be here, has a darker, more luminous quality because it has a central oculus. Each of these can have the daylight reduced through these blinds which interlock, so you can show video and film. One thing that's extremely important to do in a gallery space now is to provide that range from highly daylit spaces for painting and sculpture down to the kind of light levels which allow you to see video. But there's still, at that kind of light level, there's still enough light within the room that you can just see other people in the room. As you walk in, it's not entirely dark. You have a sense of who's there. That's something that we had wanted to do, and I think we've achieved. Although these spaces tend sometimes to be not dark enough for certain types of display. This section shows the office and the way that the new forms and the old forms relate in a pictorial way. We often find, as we, you know, we start with planning and massing, and as we draw the sections, there's another quality within the plan, which I hope you'll see, and the section, which is not put in there, but somehow purely architectonic. There's another layer of organizing, which is only really available when we have these kinds of discussions. This is completely baffling, this system here. That's why everything's going into disarray. This is a visiting artist studio, which is buried in the ground. And so if you work on video, which they tend to do in this space, if the video is there when you're sitting, the grass is also on your eye level. And that tree is very, very high. So you literally are in the country. You're buried in the country. And this is a fire escape, which can be moved. It's not fixed. It can be changed in position so that the room can be reconfigured. And the drawing here looks at our intention. It's very faint, I apologize. But from that central gallery space, there are narrow views into spaces like this, which on this drawing is illustrated here. So that when you're in the middle of an exhibition, when you see work statically placed on the wall, you can also see into these kinds of workshops and see work being made. And then you can see beyond that through the windows of the building, either in this case out to the country, or more significantly, you can look back at the town. So there's a definite effort to place art in a specific way, surrounded by activity, surrounded by the village. And the hope here is that you can get a complete and effective tension, but coexistence of art being art and life being life, and yet a proper appreciation. It's important in Britain. There's a massive problem with local art centres. Local art culture tends to be rather diminished. One thing that's very important about this kind of project is that it's very attractive to good artists, and it means that local artists and international artists exhibit together, and local people, and especially local school children who use this project very much, find that throughout the course of their early life they see art at an extremely high quality, and it becomes a normal event for them. These slides are slightly out of focus, but this is slightly out of phase. This section shows the visiting artist studio and its relationship with the ground. This is really going wrong. Sorry, this is the final gallery that is within the existing building, and again it has a different quality because there is a clear evidence of its prior existence, and yet its manner of treatment is very similar to the other galleries that I showed. And there's a desire here that what's old and what's new are ambiguously related. And these are the two final slides that I'll show. One, a photograph taken by an ex-student of mine from Lausanne called Ralph Blettler, who recently was at the last year was at the AA in fifth year in diploma school. And this is the inside of the gallery that I showed before, with a very charmingly perplexed person standing looking at an object. And here, some strangely reminiscent sculpture, but also at the back there, I wonder if you can see that the store area opens up to the courtyard, and from time to time it's able to be used as a secondary display space. And that's also true of the last gallery that I showed. The doors open and you could exhibit or have a performance piece that extended into the car park. And here there's a, it's not possible to see, I know, but there's another building that you made further over on the other side of the site, artist studios made from an existing building reflected in the window of this building. And these images are by an artist called Diego Ferrari, whose work you would probably have seen downstairs in the display at the Triangle Bookshop. Diego's work consists in making photographs of other artists at work using a camera which he's modified so that he can shoot continuously. And so these are continuous shots. And that allows him to make a choice of either overlapping objects, images, or making space between them. And through this process, he can develop a sense of time and space that's highly unique. And these are photographs of the buildings at the stage when it was being built with dry lining and stud work. This is a strange one. This is a really strange building. We didn't do this, by the way. This is by a military architect whose name I don't have access to. But this is probably the oldest living project in the practice. It's kind of gone on forever. It's tiny, but it's in Reading. Andrew, what are you doing? It's killing in here. Don't you find it hot? It's really difficult. It's terrific. Thank you. Can you just keep doing that while I speak? When students come to the AA, this is their first experience of a controlled environment. But so this is in Reading. I mean, Reading is... Is there anybody here from Reading? It's a terrific town. Reading is an interesting place. But what's curious is that, I mean, this is Reading on this plan. This is that thing there, is this thing here. This was part of Reading Barracks, and it was an armament store, and the ground floor of it was a prison. I mean, intensely oppressive place, which with some immense care and great searching, artists found and used as a studio. And actually, it does work as a studio. It's a little curious, but they do make it work. And they cling there like house martins, you know, against all odds. And have a very active exhibition program, and have had for years. In fact, it's true to say it is the only contemporary art space in Reading. Reading Borough is conspicuously chosen not to support the arts or any other art form. So this kind of activity, as in Artsway, becomes very, very significant. The activity of a few determined individuals in the Britain that we know and love becomes the only way in which culture exists. And they are in this godforsaken place, which you need a car, preferably a kind of rusting Ford, to get to, which seems to be their favourite means of transport. And yet they have a very large invisible network of activity. They have artists who exhibit there who are very credible. They also teach very widely. They exhibit very widely. So in this, I was going to say godforsaken place, there is the kind of activity that's very intrinsic to Britain, very quietly hanging on for dear life and making all the difference. So these next four photographs will show the character of this space. This area is rabidly militaristic. I mean, it has this kind of anal polished quality. Everything is within that gate is absolutely spick and span. And then next to it you have the artist studios. And if you look back out of that gate, on the other side of the road is miles and miles of dumb housing of the worst kind you could ever imagine. And then over the other side is a war memorial, which is to decent people who laid down their life for a very good cause. But all of this is, and probably these people probably lived in those houses, but what's striking about these buildings to which we're going to attach something is that there is there's a style to them, you know, a kind of a style used to depress you. It's very strange. It's it does exist. It has an absolutely clear stylistic presence. And when I look at it as a designer, tuned as we all are to how objects can be compelling. These are compelling. I mean, they're dreadful because they frighten me and they are representative of the things that I truly dislike. But so in this early scheme, in these early scheme drawings, this isn't the scheme. The scheme is a little bit more developed and you'll probably remember it from the exhibition room. But it was evident from the brief that we were going to get a very small building. We were going to get a building this size. And this building was this size. So there was a clear delight at a kind of tiny building that would, you know, stand next to the other building, and how are you going to make that one work? How do you make that one work? And it actually took a long time for us to figure out how we would do it. Originally I was going to make it a highly abstract object, but then that all got absorbed in sway and used up, so I didn't want to do that. And anyway, it didn't really work. You know, for ages we tried to persuade the planners that it would be like a Barragan-esque space, but we never really believed it, and neither did they. So what we did is this. This is an experiment. This is Glenn's beautiful photographs, completely mangled by me and made invisible. So for this, Glenn, I apologize, but I forgot to get any slides at the last minute, and so I'm extemporizing here. But this is technology. Anyway, this is, as you can see, the castle, and this is what we're going to do to it. And this model is the castle with the top removed. And then this is a side view. I told you it was going to be pedestrian, but it will get better. And the first floor, in fact, all of the typical floors of this upper part are like this. We've sorted out the artist studios and made them work. A whole load of stuff I won't even bore you with about disabled people not being burnt to death and all that kind of stuff, which is very interesting if you like it. So let's move on to this, which is where it really starts to happen, which is the ground floor plan. Now, what we're going to do here, I know it's barely discernible from this photograph, is we're going to make the front of the building glass, and we're going to have a very shallow space behind it, which will be an exhibition space for people, plumbers hurtling by in their vans. And truly, I mean, that it will be the most visible elements of any exhibition will be in there, so that as you drive by it, you look through and you see that there is an exhibition space. And in front of that, there will be a yard. Now, that yard nominally is a space where you can exhibit sculpture, but in reality, its main purpose is to be a highly abstract version of all of the surroundings. In a way, what we're trying to do is to get a hold of this sort of eerie, peculiar combination of the militaristic and the deadbeat housing, and the faint reminiscence of rurality that still exists on the Oxford Road. In a way that I'm not going to be able to convince you of here, but I know when we do it will exist. And I say this in good heart, because one aspect of the way that we build is that it's not, it does exist finally when you do it, because there are certain things you can't convey by talk. It ends up just having to happen, and this will happen, this kind of odd abstract quality, which we got in the Listen Gallery. You know, when we showed the Listen Gallery model to the artists, they were baffled by it and couldn't understand that it would ever work, and now they all say it's wonderful. So I'm confident in saying that this space will be both massively insignificant and highly affecting. And this gallery space, so with its glass front, and with what we're going to do here, have a high degree of roof lights with light control louvers, will be a space where it has hardly any architectural presence as a building. And when you walk in, it will be very enclosing. But when you look up, you'll see the sky. So its diaphanousness will be, it'll be very light. It's not intended to be unsettling. It's intended to be incredibly diagrammatic. And its floor plan, through the way that it will have a similarity with the floor plan inside this existing building, which we're going to expose by removing a lot of the structure, will, its underlying geometric quality will somehow, I believe, give you the architecture experienced underfoot. So while it's peculiarly abstract, this building, it is actually one of the most architectonic buildings that we've designed. And a few factual points. At the back here, there's a visiting artist studio with a studio there. Is that the bathroom? Yeah, and that's the bedroom, that's the kitchen, and that's a garden, which is private, separate. That's it there. But the objective here is that we're going to fill this back area, which once was some kind of parade ground, with these objects which are massively insignificant. And somehow also point out the massive insignificance, the colossal insignificance of all that military architecture. This is the Key Art Centre in the Isle of Wight, which some of you may have seen in The Guardian on a few days ago. And it's another curious one. I mean, a lot of the work that we're doing at the moment is working with buildings which exist. And how do you approach that? Some people put classy objects within them and make the existing building a rather refined setting for their work. I'm much more interested in how buildings which have been done by other people and then used in different ways and have become absorbed in people's eyes in the town in which they're situated, that those objects, I'm just going to say found objects, but that's a kind of crummy, surrealist word, much more everyday objects, the kind of objects which I used when I was doing performance, that buildings to me have that same capability, that they're very, very full of information, or very, very full of potential because of the things that I've just described, that people have invested a lot of fantasy and imagination in them. So to work with those kinds of buildings is very exciting, because if you want to be provocative and distant, which I always want to be, you can really fuck things up if you go at it. So we built hardly anything here. I mean, we built a tiny piece of building here, which I'll show you in a second, which links these buildings and these buildings, which is what existed. And so you come to this building in a narrow street, through a narrow frontage, in a place where you always came to this building. This existed as an art center for about 20 years. Everything was in the wrong place. If you wanted to go to the theater, you had to go to the art gallery. Nothing worked. It was a kind of marvel of achievement in that it was very, very vital in its program. Its restaurant, for example, was the only restaurant in the Isle of Wight that served food with any sophistication. If you didn't want to eat pork pies or other kind of delights like that, if you wanted something with no meat in it or anything with any pretense of thought, this was the place that you went to. So the components were already there, and that in a sense was another aspect of the building's vitality that we would work with. So we didn't actually take it all away and replace it with something else. We readjusted it. So to move on, you enter through here, and the space within here is a bookshop, and then there's, what's intriguing is that space then becomes an outside space. You go underneath the building across a bridge here. Now this bridge is built by a maker, a worker in wood called Jim Partridge, whose work I intend to write about in the next few months. Very interesting guy. And this is made in green oak, so it will distort. As it dries, it will become more and more and more perilous, more and more kind of upsetting apparently unstable. Yeah, it's massive, he made them. These are huge members. So it has this combination of the disturbing and the supportive. But as you walk across this bridge, you can't see it, but you look into the bar. So the plan's contrived as a come-on, a commercial come-on. I mean, these places don't exist by air. You have to make them work. So you come through the bookshop, then you go outside, then you go into the cafe, and so that is that bridge that you would cross coming outside, and that's the frontage on the water. I neglected to say that, as you'll see in this plan, there's a huge river, the River Medina, which comes all the way from the end of the Isle of Wight, from the sea, in fact, goes right into the centre of the island where Newport, which is where the building is situated, is located, and then becomes a stream and passes underneath this building. So there's a riverside frontage facing south. And in this part, which is in here on plan, and all along here, we built a terrace, made it very large. Well, we bought a pier that somebody was selling, as people do in the South Coast. Do you want to buy a pier? Well, yeah, okay, we've got one. So we bought it and put it down. Well, in fact, it was a great suggestion of the project manager. And it was everything was wiki-wacky until all the tar started to seep out of it. And so that's an ongoing problem. But anyway, this building here is a kind of half sun terrace, but it's also, what it does is it gets you undercover again into this little building here. Now this little building here is great. It was a store for the riverboats. This was a rope store. Now all the ceilings are incredibly low, about 2 meters high. So this building has 3 floors and this has 2 floors. And so to go through again, if you come from C Street into the shop and you go outside and you go into this building, which I'll illustrate in a second, which is a cafe and workshops, and then you go out again through here, and then you go in again. So there's this whole sequence of going in and out. And while you do that, you look across to the town. Part of the objective of this is to project onto, to actually, let's put it this way, collect together all of the efforts of 20 years of providing something different, let's say providing the only culture in the Isle of Wight, in Newport, and project it very visibly back to the town in a kind of slightly funny left bankist way, I might say. So this is what it looks like. That's the door into the that smaller gallery. I wonder, yeah. So here in this photograph is taken from here looking back in this direction. My photographs aren't fully complete yet. One thing we find about buildings is it takes several goes to get the photography to say what we want, so I'm extemporizing here, but perhaps you can see these have got glass screens, and this is a place that you eat. And the Key Art Center always had this rather odd but magical combination of events. You would have somebody serving food, somebody playing music, and somebody making something in a workshop in the background, all occurring at the same time. And we've done it again. In fact, you can eat here, and one minute there's a Tai Chi class, and the next minute there's a painting class. And if you want to make these spaces work all the time, you have to jam them with activity. And this place really works all the time. And hello, didn't work out right. So a tiny point about detail. This door here is one of the doors from the cafe area, and it looks out into the quay. This was an appalling rainy day here, but you can see that boarding there. These doors have very large double glazing because they have a licensing problem. The dear people in the Isle of Wight are ferociously litigious and will take their license away if they possibly can. So we have to, if they want to play music, they have to have these doors shut. So we've done it. You know, they can do everything they want, and it works. So we've kind of got it working for them. And on the first floor, a tiny point here, these windows are the theatre. They have a shutter, wooden shutter that closes over them so that when it's a dark theatre, they're like that. But they also have lights between the window and the white panels so that at night they have this sort of strange, rather doll's house quality, which I'll show you with a slide in a minute. Here we go. This is that slide. This is it at night. And one thing that perhaps you didn't see before is that in that linking area, which has got boarding, it has a window behind it, this window in fact. So the boarding runs over it. And that that's what it looks like when you look through the boarding. There is a point to this, which is that this is massively used by young kids. Dance classes are really where they make their money. I mean, the theatre space is has retractable seating. It can be a theatre, but it's also heavily used for exercise and practice. And ballet classes in these kinds of towns are a major place where young kids go to learn. And this area here is the dressing room and green room. This is a place where, on a summer's day, if you open those windows, kids could feel some sense of enclosure and a slightly cheeky quality of being able to look out at people without being seen back. And to be more architectonic, this is a section through the link. This is the terrace, and that's that space I showed you. So, surprisingly, from this side, it doesn't exist. And then from the other side, which I'm just going to show you, it's a very solid building. That is one of the rooms in the rope store, which that column height would be just over 2 meters. So on the road that runs along the back of this site, this is the elevation that we made. That elevation would be that. And so it's a back entrance to the art center. And it also has, it's the place where you take pictures and you do the theatre get-in through there. So at some times of day, these doors are open and people are hauling stuff in, you know, pantomime horses, scenery, doublet and hose, fake blood. I mean, you know, that I always have to say that whenever when I had my office in Soho, that those moments where you saw the theatre get-in, I just loved, and I, you know, there seems an opportunity for that to occur here. And this little building, what it does is it continues the line of all of these buildings. This is a very curious roof. The rope store obviously ran out of sight, so they were compelled to make it narrow there and distort the roof. This is the roof that we put on the other job at Sway. So that's where it came from. And this is a funny photograph. This shows you both sides of the building at the same time. That's the riverside, and this is the other side. This is from one of the real interesting things is not only do you have the river and all of this stuff, but you've got a massive highway running at window level. So everything's happening. Everything's happening down that part of town. The first floor and the section. This is a long section in this direction, looking that way. So this is a shop which has a double height. Then there's an art gallery there, which I'll illustrate. The theatre, which I seem to be completely incapable of taking photographs of, which is a pity. The link, and then the rope store. And so we have a theatre here, an art gallery here, and then a staircase, which, again, I apologise for this photograph, but the staircase has a disabled person's lift. It's glass-sided so that as you walk up the stairs, your companion, who may be disabled, is in the glass-sided lift. You travel in the same space at approximately the same speed. And this is the gallery space. This window here would be there. So this photograph would be taken from about this viewpoint looking that way. And we originally had got, all this structure exists, as you'll appreciate. We originally had, we had money in for putting roof lights in to make natural daylight. That all went because we ran out of money. So I got intrigued with something that I'd seen at the Tate in Liverpool, which is a completely undaylit space, which spaces in the Tate at Liverpool are, with one single window, which orientates you. And unfortunately here we had a slight problem which meant that we had to have obscured glass, but the objective with this window was that it would orientate you both in the sense of there being a small amount of daylight which would give your eye some kind of register by which you could see the electric light, but had we been more successful that would have given a view to the exterior from one point in the room. But the final thing to say about these top floor spaces is that their windowlessness makes them, if the ground floor space is a realistic space, or a realist space, if the ground floor space, as it aims to do, makes both the makes the social form be the art form and relates it very extensively to the surrounding area, this space is intentionally an imaginary space because of its detachment from the exterior, and it's a preoccupation with its own inner theatric and artistic activity. Okay. This is a job we're doing for Brad LeCour and Eden Enfer. This is the building at noon, and this is the building slightly later. Spot the difference. What we have to work with is an existing Victorian loft building, or an industrial building which has become their home, and with the studio at the back. And then at this moment in time, there's a single-story building here, which is all that's left from a building that was originally much larger and burned down. So we're being asked here to build another building on the side which has a dual function, that it can be used as a separate flat, it could be rented, or that it could ultimately join with this building and become a part of it. And in this building, this was, I think, probably the start of my preoccupation with looking at fenestrated buildings, buildings with windows and solid. And it has also a connection with my desire to, my appreciation, I should say, of London Georgian houses, which are fantastically economic in their construction, and have an aesthetic which is both regulatory, recognisable, and urbanistic, and yet immensely capable of being adjusted. I mean, I'm sure all of you by now know of several instances in London squares where the end house has the door on the side elevation, which relieves the front room to be much bigger because it doesn't have an entrance hall, and where the spacing between windows is altered in relation to the length of the terrace so that its composition is sightly. And that's at play in this building. But also what's at play is the architecture or the kinds of buildings that were produced, for example, by Oud in Holland, which, if you know Kieferk, it has... it's clearly from the modern movement, and yet if you look into it, it's full of images from the past. You know, you look through the living room, out through the kitchen, and there's a garden shed of remarkable old-fashionedness, or a traditional Dutch stair. And it intrigues me that in modernism, in those kinds of buildings in modernism, that there was, especially given that they were popular housing, that there's both this contemporaneity and a real unashamedly old-fashioned reminiscent quality, which I also appeal to. But the third, there's another element to this, which is that I'm also interested in buildings which are unconscious of architecture, where, let's say, you might say bad buildings where decisions are made which aren't to do with taste. And these kinds of things are about how that happens. And in this particular instance, which I'll show you in the plan, it allows us to have enormous freedom to adjust the windows so that it suits the room behind it, while at the same time the building has a sense of order and a sense of centrality, and yet at the same time a kind of odd dispersed quality in these windows. So, wrong slide. The final thing to say is that this building will be made of the same brick as that, and it will be continuous, but it will be painted. It will be painted very, very thinly with a glaze, a Chaim mineral paint, which is a paint based in water glass, which has been used in the Tyrol, for example, to make those decorated houses. So we can apply that very thinly. And it, in a curious way, it makes the building a painted image of itself. And tiny things, for instance, on these windows here and here, we want to put a mirror on the reveals because the view forward is not bad. It looks into a gap in the boundary estate. The boundary estate's a considerable piece of building which in the next 5 years will be recognized for what it is. But what there's something about light in Britain which I personally find very difficult. In the midwinter days when there actually isn't enough of it and there isn't enough of anything in cities. In a small way, what we're trying to do is just increase the angle of view, so when you look out the window, you don't just see that much, you see all of this. And it's it'll have an effect on the elevation, precisely what I'm unsure. But this element here also is a play in a similar way. This is the doorway to the studio at the back, which I'll illustrate in a little while. But it has a glazed screen behind it that can open. But in front of it, it has a mesh screen, a bit like a bed spring, which allows these studio doors to stand open and allows there to be an interplay between the activity in the street and the activity in the studio. So how we make this elevation, the starting point is an observation of how traditional, well, not traditional, architecture of the past has allowed itself to produce coherence in its imagery and yet enormous flexibility in the disposition of its elements. And what we can do with that is we can make the animation of this elevation not occur through architectural ornament. We can make it occur through pieces of work that we do which reflect effectively the activity behind it, which are usable in a social sense. This allows a contact with the street. This bathroom window will be white glass, a bit like a kind of pirate with an eye patch. So that's simple, but I believe effectively how we're going to do it. And this is the section. So the studio is here, and this is very small. So you have this combination of scales, very large scale here, which you would see from this living room as you looked out onto those studio roof lights, and yet the petite, very directly small scale of the house itself, and this sense of this building being like a figure on horseback almost on the studio. So I'm going to use the construction plans, or not the construction plans, the detailed design plans to explain this project, and I'll explain it simply and quickly. This is the ground floor, the studio is here, so the section that you see here would be looking this way. That's the entrance to the studio. This is the entrance to the house above, and that's the staircase. This is the first floor, and it's all living room, which stretches from there to there. This is the street, as you'll appreciate. These are the windows that would have mirror glass on them. They also, we believe, will have shutters on them, shutters which come halfway through the window, so that at night you'll still be able to see the ceiling. So there's still a communication of the volume of the space, a kind of neighbourliness with the street. And the kitchen is here, so that the shape of the staircase, which is straight there and turns into a dog-legged staircase there, gives us that space where we can put the kitchen in. Now, as an architectural plan, you probably are not convinced by it, but actually this is almost exactly the arrangement that exists in the building that's presently occupied on the other side, and it has some considerable presence. And the kitchen, the cooker, is here. So I'm more interested in working by eye and experience than what it looks like on the plan. This end faces south and is the living room, and it has a terrace, a flat area there, south facing area, which is enclosed by this wall which supports the edge of the roof lights. And this is the top floor. A single bedroom now. It used to have two bedrooms. And a bathroom contrived so that this window, which has been shifted over, is in the center of the room, and it's enormous. The floor is raised, The floor is raised so that we can sink a shower into the floor, but actually it's raised because it's beautiful, so that you walk up into this space. This window, which is very, very large, fills the entire bathroom. And you can kind of look out of the window and see the street and not be seen. And all of this stuff is kept there so that you can keep that door open, so that what you see from the stairway is just a bit of space. We did a flat in Chelsea ages ago for a couple. They had a huge rambling flat and they wanted lots and lots of different bathrooms, lots of rooms with functions, and we consciously concealed every bit of furniture, not by building it in, but just by the way that you could look into the room, because what we wanted to do is to produce that effect that you have in an Italian palazzo, where you think, why have they got so many rooms? But it's incredibly beautiful. So there's this sense of making a sense of abundance where out of very little. And this goes back to the economy that I was talking about in 18th century houses. And again, you know, I know in this school there's a completely underwhelming attitude to plans and sections, but look at the difference between this. I mean, this shows you something, but it doesn't show you everything. And one thing I learned, it's interesting, when I taught in Lausanne, we did a program where we worked from the barest sketches and we worked with models. And the students got a huge way with it. And then we did the drawings afterwards. And I thought, well, that will teach them to draw. But actually what it taught me, it's foolish to say, but what it taught me is that models and drawings say different things. And you need both. So this section talks about, for example, the way that on that staircase there's going to be this terrific skewed view. And that we're just beginning to understand that this is going to be full of bamboo. That's bamboo there right now. So this three-dimensionality of the stair in this tiny house will be considerable. You know, you'll have a great dynamism of view and also a view of the sky. So this is what a sectional drawing can show. Sorry. Sorry about this. That final model is to show the scalar relationship between that entrance from the domestic part of the living room and the scale of the studio. Okay, here we go. This is a house in London on an anonymous site in Chelsea. And this is a house by Robert Adam in just near the BBC. Now you may see some resemblances between these two. But what I want to say about this is that this building does look at Adam, but it's absolutely not at all interested in all of that crap that classicism also tries to foist off on you. So there's an enormous tension between the bits of classicism that we want to use and this building. And this building's also got a lot of the Palazzo and Urbino in it, because that's a building that I love. But it's also a part of a fascination with the type of Flemish and Dutch houses that you see, where the fenestrate or the windows are actually larger in surface area than the brickwork that remains. So, when people look at this building, they start to talk about Loos and classicism. But actually, it's not about that. There's much more tension in it than that. And this shows the building in its context. This elevation is much more about the adjustment of these images of windows in that surface in a much more uncertain and graphic way. And it's touched by other architectures, but it's not about them. You know, this is one thing that writers have got to come to terms with. They have to understand that architects, you know, all that stuff about studentship of architecture, it's not about reading the books. It's about looking at the architecture and seeing how the architecture really works in the craft of architecture. And then it's having the freedom to have it or not have it. So one thing to say about this is that this is set back from this building here, and there'll be incredibly powerful negative cubistic space. If I can explain, this screen here is about 2 meters in front of this facade here, as is this. And the building adjoining is on that same plane. So while it's going to have an appreciation and love of classicism, and you'll see that throughout this building, it's also doing other things that it wants to do. So, and it also will be, this will be made of red stone. This is going to be much more sensuous than Adam. This building's happening. It'll be built in the year 2000, but it's going to need two or three more talks as we develop it. This is the back elevation. This is the side elevation, which is even weirder. And the back elevation, you have to look very carefully here, but it's this back elevation is much more at ease with its surroundings. But don't be fooled by that calmness. This kind of calmness is the kind of calmness that you find in somebody like Tirani, where it's very mild. You know, I find Tirani's work, it's not demonstrative, but intensely powerful, because it has, you know, in Tirani's case, he was had to do battle with the classical Italian historic scene, and he had to, in a way, it was so much part of his heritage that he had to use it, but his use of it was undemonstrative, and really the beauty of Tirani's work lies in the high degree of individuality of the spaces, which isn't immediately evident, and this back elevation, which will, and this is a tropical hothouse here, by the way, which will be on the same plane as this glazing here, so this is forward of all of this, and that's back of all of that. So within all of this, there's a whole lot of things going on. I mean, this is a dining room that projects from the back of the house. This is an informal living room. That big space, which I'll illustrate in a second, is an enormous salon, 5 meters high. And then there's a little sitting room and a study. But so here's the section. That's the dining room. This dining room is going to have planting on the roof and a frescoed ceiling. And one thing to say about this building is that the interior is very unlikely to be white. This is going to be ornamented and decorated. And this is going to be tough, but it's this is something that we have an amity with the client who, I mean, this building couldn't have come into existence without that degree of consensus. Consensus is the wrong word to describe a very productive situation about how this building would be both sober and yet highly activated. I mean, for example, on the roof, this section shows that, perhaps you can see it through there, these wings enclose a courtyard which would be planted. So the activity on the roof is played out in within or surrounded by a garden and a hothouse planted with incredible beauty. In rooms that whose ornamentation, I believe, will very probably draw their strength and direction from that natural life that surrounds it. But all of the activity will take place against the background of the sky. So, I mean, in this building, it seems to me that nature is present in an incredibly fecund way in a building which is very intentionally sober. Now, I'm going to attempt to prove that describing a building by plans can be persuasive. So ignore this. This is the basement. You wouldn't be interested in that. This is the ground floor. It goes ground first, mezzanine, and roof, or roof terrace and roof. So this is the street. This is the screen against the street, which is about 2.5 meters high. And then the real facade of the house is here. Except that this is a double garage that projects out to that screen. So here is an entrance court, and here's a court which is the garden for a staff flat. And as you enter this space, you go into this courtyard, which will be south-facing, and the screen will be in etched glass. So it will be very sunlit and able to support planting, very rich planting. And you enter either there by foot, or you drive in this double garage here. And this also is an entrance. This garage is going to be designed as a room, so that as the garage doors open, it will be delightful, and then the doors will close. So this isn't going to be a mean space by any stretch of the imagination. So you arrive here or here, and you arrive in a space which is double height. This extends upwards into the floor above, and it has a single staircase there. When you're in that room and you look back there, this gate closes, the street goes, and you have a tiny, very, very verdant garden. And then you have a view here to this back garden, which probably will be planted very much more sparsely and is walled against the Royal Hospital, which is here. So from this point, the minute you walk into the house, you're in the country, or you're surrounded by nature. Then let's say you go into this room. This is an informal living room, which opens onto the garden, with a kitchen here and a formal dining room there. Now, let's ignore the staff flat for a second and move to the first floor. So the staircase which you first came to in the entrance hall was there. It leads you to a landing here. So you look from this window into this tiny court, downwards and into the street, and also the adjoining house encloses you. So this space has terrific intimacy. Then you go into this room, which, as I've said before, is a salon 5 meters high, which has a bay off of it. And this bay has an oblique view of the River Thames, if you go in there, but you probably wouldn't go in there because you go here to the fireplace. And then you discover a staircase here, which leads down into the formal dining room. So if you have guests, they can either assemble in this room and then be taken to dinner in this room, the dining room and the floor below, or in a much more informal way, they can come and congregate in this garden. This pavilion can open to the garden, and then they can discover the salon afterwards. So here we have a space which is truly about entertaining. And in being about entertaining, it has spaces within its space. One space will be created by the fireplace, where, given that it's such a large room, a group of furniture will exist. This bay offers an opportunity for people to be slightly apart from groups of people, or if you're there on your own and you don't want to be in a big room, you can be in this much smaller intimate room, which has windows that open and look out onto that entrance court. Or there's a balcony along the back here, which looks downward onto the garden, or out across to Christopher Wren's, the grounds of Christopher Wren's Royal Hospital, or across this planting, which you can't get onto. This isn't a walk-on roof, it's a flower bed. At the back of here, there's a tiny, none of it's tiny, smaller, second sitting room with a fireplace, another fireplace. So that this is perhaps a space where you'd want to relax in a different way. The essence of this house is that it shows how much functionalist planning has penetrated our thoughts of building, and how there are other ways to make spaces. Spaces where you have more space than you need, with different characters which you occupy at different times of the day, with different purposes, and with different emotional intents. So this space would be, let's imagine, a space where you would really relax, and would open onto this end of the balcony, which again is enclosed by the projection of that house, but also enclosed by a tree here, not illustrated, in the grounds of the Royal Hospital and in the garden. So this has, when you look, when you stand in the building which exists in the site already, a fantastic intimacy. Whereas this space has a great open view to the Royal Hospital. So the character of this room is invested by something, by the view outside it, by where you choose to put the program in relation to natural and pre-existing events outside, create the interior quality of the spaces. Here, which is the floor above that area, is a study, 13 meters long, and at its narrowest point, 3 meters wide, intentionally Corbusian, inasmuch as also this ground floor is very, very, let's say, a space of the modern movement, whereas all of this is much more recognizably and identifiably part of a neoclassical tradition. This hovers somewhere between the modernism of the Unité, and also those spaces which you would find in Urbino, the ducal apartments, which, if you've ever been there, are the smallest spaces you've ever seen, where they have trompe-l'oeil marquetry, things that fold down from the wall, tiny, tiny spaces in relation to enormous reception rooms, almost as if the Duke of Montefeltro was utterly sick of big spaces and wanted tiny spaces. This is a study which looks that way toward the street and that way in a similar way to that. And then the staircase, which I forgot to mention to it, is concealed between a double wall here. So as you walk into this space, you look up and you see a view of the sky right the way through the roof. That staircase also breaks at that point so you can get into the study and then continues up to the rooms on the roof. So the rooms on the roof consist of a tropical hothouse here, which is glazed on all of these sides, a garden with a hot tub so that you can bathe in the winter while looking through the tropical hothouse to the Wren Gardens, if you want to. And then a master bedroom, a small balcony along the back here, which would, the east light will touch this. That would be a great place for breakfast. And then a bathroom here with a place to change, all of which look out onto this, I would imagine, densely planted court. And these pavilions are set back from the parapet. These spaces are about 80 centimeters wide. So in this room, which is a guest room, this would be a place where you could privately sit, drawing the blinds here, so that you could have some privacy from your host. The same also here. But this, which you'll probably see much more accurately on the model in the exhibition, is solid up to, or down to, the level of the parapet, and then glazed below. So when you take a shower, there's a window about this height which looks down into planting in this very narrow space. And these holes in the wall, which will be configured in a way that you find, I mean, this is playful, but it's in the way that you find in Renaissance buildings, where the scaffold holes are left, or the brickwork didn't quite get faced in stone, and the fixing holes are left. These will be configured like that, but they give you a view from that terrace, and very probably from sitting in your hot tub to the River Thames. So this is a place of intense enjoyment. It's not luxury. It's about doing what you should do in houses. Instead of making everybody's life a complete enclosed misery, you should have spaces like this. You should enjoy cities. So this is where it's at. This final thing to say is that this roof light is this shape because we wanted it to reflect very selectively as you walk along the street. For example, that part would be dark and you may see through it, and that will reflect. So it will sparkle just a little, and yet it won't be, it'll be unclear whether it's a rectangular form or whether it's got distortions in it. So in that sense, it will be part of the vocabulary of forms in this space, which are column and beam. Final project. This is the competition entry that we made for the Le Ban Dance Center, which was won by Herzog and Dimeron, and judged by Edward Jones and my other people, and my good friend Zaha Hadid. And we were struck. This is in Deptford, I should say. Deptford is near Greenwich. Deptford's history, which isn't evident anymore, was that it was a very vital boat building place. I think Captain Cook left from Deptford to explore Australia. And there's an eerie presence left. There's, for example, this church by Thomas Archer, which is staggeringly good, actually. But now what's remarkable is the amount of sky that you see. This is a true shot from over here. And so there's a very particular and intense quality which comes from the fact that you have a big sky with objects like this, just touching it, or the spire of that church. And the other element which produces excitement in me was Deptford Creek, which is here. I should say, by the way, sorry, it's impolite of me, I should have said that this is the building that we are going to discuss. This is Deptford Creek. Deptford Creek is sometimes completely empty and sometimes full. It's a tidal inlet to the River Thames. The River Thames is about here. Greenwich is about here, somewhere over here in relation to this model. And the Laban, I should also say, was there are effectively two dance centres in London, the London School of Contemporary Dance and the Laban Centre. And Laban is at the moment in, where is it? It's in New Cross, in a very strange building, which is ungainly, but actually works. And they had got a right of purchase, or an offer of purchase, on this site, which currently is a municipal, I think it's a refuse reprocessing site. And it's not too far from the area that they're in. The New Cross site is absolutely surrounded by dancers. It's true to say that all dancers in England live in London, and most of them live near New Cross just because accommodation's cheap. The Laban gives it some kind of force. There's a dance community there. That will have a place in the discussion that will follow. But in saying that these things affected the design, you'll have to judge for yourself the indirectness of their effect. I mean, these effects are not, I can't say this affected that. It's overall, the sensibility in the building is somehow related to the things I'm showing you. This place here is here. In this model it's extended, but actually currently it only occupies that site. And a very interesting thing occurred as we were being briefed on this project. A lady who worked in Nature Conservancy addressed us and said that Deptford Creek had a problem of sustenance of wildlife, or actually sustenance of insect life upon and weed and vegetal life, which had impacted upon the bird life. So that, and this had been caused by a very simple phenomenon. In let's say until 30 years ago, the banks of the creek were shored up using timber, and on the timber ledges you got grass like this growing, and on the grass insects and butterflies lived, and on the insects and butterflies other things lived, and eventually you got a vital marine life, which went, because actually, for very interesting and sensible reasons, the river started to be supported by driven sheep piles, which don't have any ledges on them. So her objective was to, and she's being very effective in this, is to reintroduce, among other things, those kinds of positions in the river edge where life can grow. But this was one of her projects. And you might think, what is this? And I said to her, what is this? And she said, well, actually, it's the kind of habitat that certain types of insects really like. It's an urban site where there's a very thin covering of earth on rock. I mean, my knowledge of wildlife's minimal, but this is a place that's very widely used in this area. This is a place where certain types of wildlife exist, not in a demonstrable way, in a very subliminal way, well, a liminal way, but the way that's not like, we're not talking longleat and lions, we're talking about a much lower level of appreciation, but people do use this. These people in this housing estate use this and appreciate it. So one of the things that we had intended to do was to extend that and to make the roof of our building be a planted roof, and to make the courtyard planting, the roof planting and this planting be related. So that in our building, as well as dancers, you'd get other life forms existing. So the ambience of this space would be changed, not dramatically, but significantly. Wow, what happened there? This is This is Thomas Archer's church, seen from this direction. And this is one of the objects that you see on the sky. And now I'll talk about the ground floor plan. There are a few slides and then we're finished. This, to orientate you, this space here is this. This courtyard is that courtyard. So the building consisted principally of dance studios, which are arranged here. Anything with a tan floor is a dance studio. Anything grey in this area is a cafe and a foyer, and here is an enormous corridor. So you had dance studios, some teaching studios, and dancers have a surprisingly large academic curriculum, which consists of reading books on dance theory, but also looking at videos of choreographers' work, so that their education isn't just body education anymore. They're very, very aware of the of how dance is an art. And art and dance has become very, very extraordinarily interesting. For example, it's not unusual now for dance students to make a piece of choreography within their examination work, which is site-specific, which is something which wouldn't be unusual to visual artists, but I was unaware of as dancers. So dance is up there. Anyway, this part here is a theatre, a specifically designed dance theatre. That's the auditorium. I think, I can't remember, 350 seats, or maybe 500. And this is the dance stage. Now the dance stage, it turns out, and the auditorium are about the same size and very, very close, because in their current theatre, they can fill it, they can fill their current theatre without any advertising to the public, simply from dancers and choreographers. So the audience here is an audience of dancers and choreographers looking at other dancers dancing. Very specific event, not entertainment. This is an exchange of artistic points of view that's occurring here. So this theatre, just to make some small technical points, has a backstage area, or rather a scenery store, which can open so you can have an enormous stage, or it can have a stage, the same area as the stage, which can be a practice stage. And this dance studio has a dance floor the same size as the theatre, so that dancers can practice pieces while another performance is going on here, on a stage which has the same orientation and same size as in the theatre. One thing I wanted to say was that this space has a specific significance. It's the principal entrance. And in this work, we were looking at how you could make a believable place, a place of vitality, in a location which is slightly remote, not unusually remote, but not availed of those kinds of cafes, shops, supermarkets that you would find in a regular situation. How could we do some things within the limited material that we had of the brief and the location to make a believable space? So this entrance space, this would be the place where not only dance students would come every day, but visiting companies would come. The choreographers coming from Japan or Germany would have to find this. This place would have a very particular shape, and it would be lined on the floor above with the backstage areas of the theatre, things like the wig-making room, costume room, changing room. And you can see perhaps in these sketches identical viable marker, which we, in an exotic moment, felt would be clad in gold metal. So from a distance, that would be where you would know where the school was. As you got closer, as you went in there every day, this would be a place which was very domestic in scale, full of activity. As I said, on this side, the theatre backstage, on this side, a sports injury clinic, a growth industry, sports injury. Something you know nothing about, it's going to be, put your money in sports injury, I guarantee it. So the other aspect of this is also that it looks out onto a whole load of residential housing, which currently is sort of bitterly without responsive context on the other side of the street. So what we were saying here is that, yes, it's a dance school, but its level of detail, its level of manifestation, its expression is domestic. So this place looks at the space across the way and says something to it. It also, this space also has a similarity of shape. It turned out, this wasn't conscious, to the churchyard at the back of the Thomas Archer Church. But broadly, it's true to say that in this building, it's one of the efforts was to make the geometry, the plan shapes of the building as they were visible, not the intrinsic ones, as I was talking about in the project at Sway, but the actual visible plan forms, like this and this, be at home and working with the geometries that were occurring in the surrounding area, which you perhaps might remember and appreciate from that site model that I showed. I need to say two things, and then I'll move on. In a dance school, or specifically in the Laban dance school, the corridor area has a very great significance. It's actually managed in the Laban by having departments be distant from each other so that people are constantly walking through that space. And of course it sounds absurd and utterly ridiculously straightforward, but it does work. It means that unlike schools where the admin is locked away and you never see them, the head of the school is there in the way that the AA works, that the bar works in that way. So this area serves that function. And against this garden, it has rooms which were for physiotherapy and resting. And those corridor spaces have a distinct function in dance schools. Dancers between classes or before classes stretch, and they need space to stretch. They also need places where, if they get sprains, they can have, you have ice fridges and you put ice on sprains. So there's a whole load of character activity that goes on in corridors. They also study in corridors. They sit and read very assiduously. They also would sit and read in this area here, which is the cafe, which I'm now going to illustrate. So this is the entrance courtyard. This is the theatre foyer where the furniture's all been overturned by a wild party the night before. And this is the cafe, which looks out onto a central garden full of kind of second-hand furniture, this isn't too jokey. I mean, actually, we had wanted to make a space that could accept the type of thing that goes on in schools, the type of wild and interesting degradation that goes on in schools. I've spilt my bottle of water into the control panel, so I don't know how much longer we've gone. But fortunately, I didn't get any on my suit. Well, it seems interesting. I seem now to have... Jesus, what a nightmare. Right, here we go. This is the first floor. This is the first floor. The building has two floors, two identical floor plates. And I was interested in how you could make each floor have a different character. You know, make each floor have a different character by your choice of program. The ground floor has a riotous feeling. You know, it's about body culture. At the other end, in the floor below, the student common room is far enough away that people can create mayhem, but just within sight of the public so they can offend them, which is, I think, the right way things should be. On this floor, this sketch shows a rather more serious space, which is the library here. It also shows this room here, which is a theatre design studio. These rooms, although they contain dance studios, along this edge would have tutor rooms. You know, they see their tutor for academic study and tutorials. It would also have the offices of the Dance Theatre Journal, which is a significant publication which emanates from within the school. So this is a slightly cooler type of space. So that said, the library desk is the place where people flirt and talk. I mean, that's where it happens. And that is underpinned by the sort of bohemian activity in the art studio, but also something here. This window relates you to the distance. And one thing that we do in this building is we both make it intensely internal. We pack it with activity, putting one activity next to another, letting the staircase come from the cafe up into this part of the plan, put things next to each other in a way that we know will be productive, while at the same time always relating this building in particular to the wider world. And it's a metaphor in a sense for the connection of this building or this institution to the wider world of dance. So I wonder, let me press some buttons and see if I can blow the place up. This section is through here. This is a study section. This section is through this way, looking in this direction. That's the ground floor, that's the first floor. These are two typical dance studios. These dance studios would be naturally ventilated, but acoustically treated. Or to put it another way, we wouldn't have air conditioning in here, and we would do it by chimneys. I mean, this is not worked out, and very, very open to criticism, but we were working with overarching partners, and we were certain that we could do it. But exhausted air leaves by an air chimney, air comes in through here and is diffused through perforations in these panels, which also conceal acoustic absorbent, because as you'll appreciate in a dance studio, the dance master and the piano have to be intelligible to the dancers, so you need some acoustic absorption. There's also a problem in dance schools, in any institution, that they get dirty all the time, you know, so that these wearing areas where dancers put their feet up are what you have to have. But the thing to say about these studios is that we made a conscious effort to give each of the studios a specific character in relation to their location. So this one is related next to the car park. I wonder if I can change this slide and make it live for you. Yes, okay. So the car park is beyond this mirror. A high window here brings light onto the dancers who would stand here, who would see themselves well illuminated in the mirror. This dance studio would be the kind of space where dance that was oriented to theatrical productions, a proscenium stage would take place. This is a dance studio that would have front, as they say, whereas some of the other studios over here would have windows in several different directions and much more orientation to the sky, and would be much more the place where contemporary dance would take place, which would perhaps operate within the audience. And this is the upper floor in detail. And one thing I wanted to say was that the view from the window in the dance studio has some significance. The upper floors here would have a view into the sky. I believe it's important that you have some objects upon which you can focus your eye, but not a lot of immediate foreground activity. Because dancers, when they practice, and then they rest, and they need to somehow be off stage and looking at something. So part of the objective here was to orientate dance studios so that their views were beneficial in that sense. These few final slides show how we approached in a competition entry what the building would be like. We said that it would be a solid building. We said that it would have windows in it. We said those things because you get a lot of good things ensuing from that. You get much better control thermostatically of sun ingress, heat egress. You also get the ability in those spaces to be in them without being observed, which in a fully glazed building, you don't, you know. And the daylight illumination in spaces like this is significantly better with well-distributed sources of daylight, with solid panels between them, which within them provide surfaces where light can interreflect. So the illumination in those spaces is much kinder. This was our approach in the exhibition, which we soundly lost. We said that such an elevation wouldn't necessarily have to be burring, as it was described, but actually could begin to take its character from the material that you choose. And this was Thomas Archer's church photographed close up to show how stone would work. This slide's objective is to show that we were going for a single big form. And the single big form's purpose was to show a singularity of space, to show the school as a community, but also to operate at a scale in the wider surroundings so that it could place itself among the very large buildings that surround it. So I wonder where I'm at. So I need to go back. No, I don't. What we find in this area is an industrial landscape like this, and also Thomas Archer's church. So this building, we would want to negotiate that. We would want it to both be able to be muscularly large in the same way as the industrial architecture, but also to be able to avail itself of incident in the same way as classical architecture did. So with this type of elevation, it can accept incidents which are driven by purpose. For here, for example, on a south-facing elevation, you could have a brise-soleil, you could have a balcony. In the window fenestration itself, you could have different types of windows, a window that opens in at the top where you wanted privacy, a window that opened far more generously in a tutorial room. It's also true to say that this type of elevation is capable, in the way that I've described in 18th century building, of expanding and contracting its elements to take up changes or opportunities in the program. And in a competition, after the competition is won, the program really starts to be defined. So we thought a strategy that was the way to do it. Hello, wait a second. I think that might be the end of the lecture. Either that or I've fused the lights, but thank you very much. Yeah, of course I will.
Now I know why Tony was so keen to start at 6:30. He knew how long it was going to take.
Yeah, sorry about that.
I won't ask the first question. Maybe we could have some questions from the floor.
Yeah.
Do you have a microphone?
I can hear you.
Yeah, but John, is there one or?
I can listen to his question and tell it to the audience.
The last project, there was a stair in it that was very large, almost a room itself coming up from the cafe.
Yes.
And you talked about the audience of light, character of light, dance.
Yeah.
The Chelsea house, almost talk about the house, one might talk about the house in terms of the courtyards and the circulation in conjunction with these courtyards. The connection, the direct link between the dining room and the salon seems very unusual in the context. Would you speak a little bit about the genesis of this connection?
No.
You're going to repeat that question?
Well, let me answer it in a simple and straightforward, generic way. We tend to make the spatial connections outside what you would call a proprietary sense of how things should be, but much more in relation to our discussions with our clients and their lifestyles. But then there are adjustments made in the light of how that house, they may want to sell it, it may have to suit somebody else, their lifestyle might change. So we're capable of making unusual connections between conventional spaces, which are capable also of being remodeled or reconfigured. So there isn't I think it's true to say that I am relatively uninterested in the architecture of sequence. And I mean, I'm much more interested in how a plan can have an intense looseness while the building can have a sense of composure, and that one will be at odds with the other. And if you look at those plans very carefully, there are enormous mismatches. I mean, for instance, the hot house is over here. It allows a small window from the major bedroom into the central courtyard. which wouldn't happen otherwise. If everything lined up in a regular way, that wouldn't happen. So I'm very loose in the way that I plan things. You know, that doesn't worry me at all. In fact, actually, it produces better forms. And in a way, I also look for an opportunity that chance things that are not driven by aesthetics, can produce another kind of beauty, very unexpected beauty. Irene. Hang on.
Is there a microphone or no? Do we not have a microphone?
Well, I got a microphone. You're going to do on this one.
Yeah.
Anyhow, try that. It's a bit far away. You might have to shout. Yes?
You mentioned spaces which would be insignificant but affecting. And what that suggests to me is that the aim, perhaps, is to make spaces, you have used that word, which have presence. Now, you also talked about Carl Andre, and I can understand quite readily what presence might be, say, in an artistic context. I'm wondering what it might mean in an architectural context. And if I could just add one thing. I mean, one way which architects have of documenting for themselves and perhaps for others the presence of their work is through photography. And one thing which actually sticks in my mind is that, say, when architects like Herzog de Meuron want to give a record of the presence of their works, they asked Thomas Roof, for example, to make photographs, and those photographs are very closed. And by contrast, when, for example, you photograph the Listen Gallery, though you haven't done it again, you have asked a photographer from Magnum. And to me, that suggests a very, very fundamental difference about what to you presence might be. And what is it?
Well, the kind of presence that I seek, I mean, let me give you an example in the Listen. It seems, for example, those galleries are rough and ready in their proportions. They look as though they're square, they look as though they're a half cube, but they're not. And they're very, the proportions are very throwaway, partly because I don't have much respect for architectural proportion, but also because I had wanted them to have a similarity to the type of enclosures that you see in the surrounding area that happen by happenstance. So it's that kind of presence where the objective in the Listen was that you'd provide a space which, well, was not invisible, had a sense of being there, but it didn't have a large architectural presence. It had a material presence or a social presence. So it's to get presence in spaces by means other than architectural devices. So I always look for events outside to give me the missing components. And if that hasn't answered the question, you could ask me more. I mean, have I missed the point or have I got it?
No, I think that answers it for the time being.
No, I mean, I think it's good that these things are questions.
But I don't know whether I should go on because maybe something.
No, I wish you would. I wish you would. I wish you'd just pursue it a bit more.
Will I?
Yeah, will you?
I want to come back to the difference between, say, the photography of Thomas Roof and, say, how a Magnum photographer works. That also interests me because there are clearly two photographic fashion at the moment, which are working side by side. I think both mean something which is possibly quite different and which may actually indicate something about your work. Now, the thing about a Magnum photography is that it's quite instantaneous, and possibly spontaneous in some way, I don't know. And I don't know, I had always assumed that it revealed something about what your work is.
Yes, it does. It reveals, at that stage, it revealed a desire to show the concern for making a space which was ultimately finished and completed, or made different by events outside itself. I mean, this is a very difficult thing to do. It's a large claim to make. It does seem to have been borne out in what we've done. But, you know, it could be probed. But let's say that that's the ambition, and it seems to have worked. And so, in my naive days, when I did the listen, it seemed to me very obvious to use a photojournalist to photograph people who are unconsciously in the space, and not to show very formal and hermetic photographs, which Jack and Pierre use so well. I mean, I pay a big price for that, an enormous price, because actually I've gone further than that. I won't have any photographs taken like that at all. I actually, to be honest, I don't believe that, you know, those kind of photographs that Chris took were great, fantastic photographs, but they were fictions, you know. They were another way of plugging this big bleeding hole in architecture's credibility. I think we have to have the courage to go and look at the building, and we have to have the courage to stop believing in the mediated version of the work. And it's important from another number of respects. First of all, I think it means that you can deal much more cogently with the object itself and not be endlessly pointing it to what it will look like. It also, I think, produces an architecture which can have a more extensive intelligence, because it won't always be trying to be massively successful. But that's a difficult thing to do right now, because the big steerage is towards getting it in the books, and if you don't get the right photographs, you don't get it in the books. So what do you do? Ellen just photographed Key. It's fantastic. You know, I mean, Ellen photographed Key Arts. Bava want it, you know. And she's a great photographer. You know, I have endless time for her. The photographers I'm talking about are great photographers. This critique is not laid at them. It's an unease I have about how architecture is representing itself. In the end, you get compelled to play the game, you know. That's a tricky thing. If you don't want to play the game to begin with, that's very difficult. Jack and Pierre are really happy doing all that stuff. That's where their architecture lies, and they do it with great brilliance. And when you see the buildings, they're not disappointing, they're something else. But it's something that I'm enormously resistant to. That's why every time somebody writes about me, they say, he's so reticent, he's so laconic, you know. It really is beginning to piss me off, really, because actually when you go and see the buildings are completely real, you know, and there are people in the audience tonight who've come because they've seen the buildings. They haven't read the essays in the books. They come because they appreciate the buildings, and what is conveyed to them in the buildings is more than is conveyed in this lecture, because that's where the effort goes. So I don't have an answer to this question. I mean, being angry about it isn't necessarily very good, and there are legitimate reasons why somebody in Copenhagen would want to see a photograph. I don't know. I really like those photographs that, I forget the name, the guy in the 60s did all that black and white photography of people like Sterling and, you know. Or anybody of that ilk. They had this incredibly straightforward way of doing it. I remember, you know, horses, people, absolutely, you know, no kind of self-consciousness. It just looked like it was a building in use. But they're all kind of dead or mad now, so you can't use them. So all these other people have all been to art school, you know, and what can you do? You know, their retinas have all been kind of ruined, you know. And you say to photographers, I'd really like to do something different. They go, You know, I don't know the answer to this one, Irene. I really don't. And that's why in this exhibition, to Mohsen's dismay, I think, properly, I, in my usual obstinate fashion, refused to do any drawings other than plan sections and elevations. Just to piss everybody off, just to show that actually the work of architecture and the existence of architecture is in the building. And that also that the the issues in how you build it, why you choose the way that you build it, are utterly fascinating, completely absorbing. You know, the choice of a material isn't about some dull technocratic issue. It's about knowing that you're not going to get sued in 2 years' time, which is a big issue, and that it's going to talk, and that it's going to say something as big as you want. That's really exciting. You know, that's what we talk about in the office all day. Will we do this? Will we do that? So the objective of this show is to somehow convey that, and this issue about photography is part of that. I don't know, Renee, you know, I mean, I don't know the answer to this one, but it's a fantastic question.
I wonder, isn't there also a situation where the photograph has obviously a clear status in its own right? So, in some way, the opportunity to have a Thomas Rowe photograph also has an identity, which is not just in terms of its representation of a building by Tony Fretton. And that also, I think, has a particular condition.
So of course, Mohsen.
I think that now we are getting to a point where the building somehow is being prioritized, which maybe it should be, but that there is in fact a situation where the photograph, I'm not trying to legitimize the idea of the kind of pictorial situation that is obviously prioritized in terms of the magazine, but nevertheless it seems that I think the relationship between photography and architecture has its own kind of...
Of course it does, but not... I mean, we're all capable of being absorbed by images and believing them to be the reality. You know, I mean, we're all intelligent until we go and watch television, and then we all become couch potatoes and can't think. You know, and that is the capacity of the media to actually seal off that type of critical distance. Yes, of course, it's true that the photograph is different from the work, but actually, oddly enough, often not in the mind of the architect. They're often a part of a desire to somehow impress this particular view of the building on the outside world. I think you know what I'm getting at. Mr. Hatton, the incomprehensible writer. Hi. But a fantastic article. The letter in AJ in BD was wrong, and it was a fantastic article. This guy's a writer. Diffidence, laconic. Yeah.
It's getting energy.
All right.
Trust of the professional approach to conceiving the building, because there's also a professional way of describing the building. Now, it seems to me that in addition to making the straight statement of the plan elevation sections, there is a way of conducting an attention to detail in a certain systematic way, which might begin to reveal a more coherent range, if you like, language of your moves and particular devices, particular kinds of decision that you apply in particular situations, because obviously you do have some idée fixe, whereas very often you describe your design as a kind of intuition on the spot or in relation to a sort of discovery of the building on each occasion. And I think that there is a way of beginning to, if you like, abstract a summary of your methods and your strategies.
No, I think you're entirely right. I mean, I think it... Of course we don't. It would be entirely wrong to suggest that. First of all, I'm not a professional. I mean, I do believe that architecture is a profession, and professions have a very specific role in society, and also you need to conduct the office well. You know, it needs to be sustainable as a business, and it needs to deliver things well. So in that sense, we're completely professional. But I think your point about, let's say, the depiction of the schemes is true. I mean, there is a lot that we could do to make the presence of those buildings be apparent. Let's go into this. I'm thinking of the drawings that came from Foster's office in the 70s, absolutely gripping at that time. For instance, a section through that project at Hammersmith, And they conveyed not what the building would be like, but they conveyed a massive amount of excitement about how the space of the buildings would be. Now that's, what you have to understand is that Foster's office was completely focused in its own belief in itself. Yeah? That produces a particular type of will to present itself, push itself onto the world. Now, that's something that we're going to have to do. But we're a kind of three-celled office, you know, we've developing. So all of this work up to this stage has been finding out what we wanted to say. And there's also a kind of obstinacy about not wanting to do all that stuff and play that kind of game, which is you pay a price in communication. So it starts to be the case that you have to recognize that there are themas in your work. I mean, for instance, one of which is a certain attention to space, a certain enclosure, a certain presence. And you're absolutely right to suggest that there needs to be some graphic method to convey that. But that's kind of some way off. I wish it would come sooner, but it's... I mean, you're right, I accept this criticism, but it's not there yet. It's in the buildings. Lady at the back, thank you. Thank you, Brian. No more difficult questions about drawing and presentation.
No,
I'm going to wait for you to send the microphone. Then I'm going to pretend I can't hear you.
Okay. I spoke to you when you came.
What are you doing over there? Wait a second. Yeah. Those the speakers are over there. It just sounded very funny. You're over here. And your voice came from over there.
Okay. Well, you'll have to get used to it.
Oh, thank you. as you wish. You know, I mean, you're the audience. Next question.
I'm really intrigued. Yeah.
Let's talk
about your denial that there is any connection between architecture and poetry, and it's possible.
No, there is a connection.
There is. Oh, I see.
In my view, there is a connection.
Oh, I beg your pardon. I thought that you were denying that there was.
No. I think there is.
Oh, right. Well, then I've got nothing to say.
No. I could respond to that. I'd intended to say that it seems to me that there is an analogy in my mind between a piece of poetry and a building. A piece of poetry, unlike a book or a textbook, which is voluminous and can conceal its limitedness and its voluminousness, a piece of poetry is discreetly on a page, and you can see it's very, very short, but a great piece of poetry has this capacity to give you something much more than you would imagine from that small scale and indubitably prescribed presence. And a building, too, is very analogous to that, because a building, you can see every aspect of it, I mean, apart from its interior construction, but its public face is absolutely available and actually, in a way, at the will of people who don't even know who made it. So the analogy with the poem is very, very strong in my mind. I'm reluctant to make that, just because the schools have been so full of, this year it's going to be about poetry, this year it's going to be about... But yes, I do. And I mean, another thing to say is that I am affected by other art forms. You know, I can listen to pieces of music and see not structures that I can use in my work, but I can see the sensibility of an idea that's leading to structure. I can see the artistic form. I mean, in a lot of music, I see artistic form that I really adore. Now, the relationship between that and what I do is long, distant. It may never connect, but at the very least, it sustains you in believing that to make a piece which has an artistic form, independent or as well as its function, is a good thing. So that's, in those respects, I am in agreement with you. Okay. Lady at the back.
Question.
We've only time for 16 or 17 more questions. So. Wait, you're going to have to come closer because I can't hear you. No, wait, you could... There's a kind of megaphone.
I hadn't heard of you until 4 days ago. And I went to the listening.
Thank you. Goodbye.
No. Yeah. No, it's not because you're not worth knowing about. It's just that I've been out of London.
Well, what can I say?
No.
How sad.
That's not my point. I went to the Listen Gallery on Friday.
And?
Well,
I absolutely hated it. Well,
are you interested in what
I am. I'm just fooling around because I'm a bit uncertain about what you're going to say, so I'm nervous.
I'm trying to pay you a compliment.
Thank you very much. I'll relax.
I hadn't heard of the Listen Gallery and I hadn't heard of you, and I went there. I didn't even know, hadn't made the connection until today. It's a long story, but what I experienced there was something poetic, which I don't think you can convey in photographs or graphically. And I had a brilliant experience there. And that seems to be what the quality of that was, is that it's not conveyable by those means, and that's what makes your architecture, from what I've seen now on that, is it's what makes it worth having lectures about and sharing it with other architects.
I'll stop being so crass when people ask me nice questions. But thank you very much. I mean, it is.
Have a negative criticism. Don't be so crass.
There you are. Ever exposed to criticism. Thank you. Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.